Hi, I'm Brenda Buglione, and welcome to SnowMotion. I'm standing at the top of Vail, Colorado, and I keep coming back because they have over 5,000 skiable lakers, and the views never get old. We have a great show lined up for you this week.
Would it be easier if we had no shoes, no time to kill, and nothing to lose, and no worries but the great blue sky? Shade when the sun gets high, we're climbing up that coconut tree. If it's time for one of nature's treats, would it be easier?
It's a place where I feel at home. Every run is an adventure.
Vail, it's like nothing on earth.
SnowMotion is brought to you by The New Mitch by Paul Mitchell. Style isn't born, it's groomed. And by Surefoot. Better fitting, better skiing. Winning a race is not all physical. Sports psychologist Jim Taylor tells us how the mind has to be in the game as well. Today's SnowMotion Chairlift Interview is with Dr. Jim Taylor, a sports psychologist and a former elite ski racer. Jim, I have so many questions for you. I want to know why the best ski racers are the best.
Well, certainly a lot of it is that they're just genetic freaks, that they are great athletes. Plus, they train tons. They've got tons of miles under their belt. But ultimately, at the highest level, what enabled them to be go from maybe 100th in the world to 30th in the world to top five to a Michaela Schifrin or a Ted Ligety gold medalist in Sochi is what goes on up here.
Jim, we know that even the top 30 ski racers coming down that course, any of them could win, and we know that the difference is in their head. How are you helping the athletes you're working with be on the podium?
Well, when it comes to race day, there are three areas that are most important. First is confidence. You might have all the ability in the world to get down the hill really fast, like those top 30 guys or gals in Sochi, but if they don't have that true belief in that ability, they're not going to fling themselves down and ski on the edge. And you see it with Ted Ligety, unbelievably, he skis on the edge. It's scary. Michaela's a little different because she's always seems to be in such control. But when they get in the gate, they not only believe that they can ski the fastest, they believe that they can win. So instilling that confidence is really essential.
Okay, that's number one. Number two?
Second one is dealing with pressure. Obviously at the Olympics, once every 4 years, the world is watching, their nations are rooting for them, and the gold can mean a huge difference, a medal can mean a difference between financial success and not, as well as just validation of how good they are. And so there's tremendous pressure on them, and their ability to not focus on results, to focus on just, okay, I'm in the gate, what do I need to do to ski as fast as I can? And to stay relaxed. Is another big thing. Staying relaxed under pressure is an amazing skill for these athletes.
And what I see even, you know, going up for the second run after they've won the first run and they have to do it again because the first run win doesn't matter in the end.
Right, and that's really when you separate the really good ones from the truly great ones, because then all of a sudden they win the first run, they could win the gold. And there's this expectation, and the great ones, the Michaelas and the Teds and the Bodies and a lot of the other great ones, they're able to just set that aside and again go back to, what do I need to do to ski my best? It's all about the process, not worrying about results. Because if they focus on the process, they're probably going to ski well, and if they ski well, good things are going to happen, often a medal.
Jim, you've talked about mindset. How do you apply that to these athletes?
Okay, well, with the athletes I work with, and this applies to the top guys as well, and I actually had a few athletes in Sochi, and I try to help them develop what I call a certain mindset. And the three kinds that I have identified that can help different athletes based upon their personality. Ted, for example, you know, his nickname is Ted Shred. So he has what I call an aggressive mindset. When he's in the gate, he's not thinking about tactics or technique. He's thinking about bring it, baby. Yeah. He's just going all out attacking. And you can see it in his skiing. He's on the edge every moment. Michaela is very different. People think she's this like cool as a cucumber kind of gal, but she actually has talked about how she gets really nervous at the start. So for her, a calm mindset. So she's in the start, taking deep breaths, relaxing her muscles, saying, okay, let's just chill out here, let's keep it calm.
And even she, at lunch, sometimes she does word puzzles just to keep herself not focused on the race, but on something else.
Exactly, exactly. And Bodhi, he's another animal. He's such an unbelievably gifted and talented athlete. He basically wants what I call a clear mindset. He doesn't want to think about anything at all. And he's in the start, he'll be chatting it up, he'll be smiling, he'll be relaxed, and because he has such faith in his body to do what it knows how to do. So it's just keep the mind out of the way.
For him, he just goes for it, oh my gosh. You know, he's such an example for these kids to ski on the edge too, right? And just rely on your athletic instincts.
Absolutely, and a big thing about Bodhi, he's my poster child for the attitude for a ski racer, because he's never cared about results. All he cared about, and this is from his autobiography, all I ever cared about was skiing as fast as humanly possible. And whether he finished first or 15th, as long as he felt like he skied his best, he was a happy guy.
What do you tell someone that's at the top of a really steep run, or you're in the starting gate, or you're in a chute? How do they calm their nerves?
That's a big one, because obviously if they're not physiologically prepared to ski their best, if their muscles are tight, if they're not breathing, then they're not gonna be able to ski very well. And that applies to the World Cup Olympians in Sochi, or skiing on a steep trail in the back bowls of Vail. Biggest, most obvious one, and people forget all the time, is breathe. Simply take some deep breaths. Simple, easy. We can't survive without breathing. We can't ski well without oxygen in our systems. So taking deep breaths. Second of all is just shake out your muscles. Get your muscles loose, because there's no way you can absorb bumps if you're skiing like this. And so that is really good. And then going back to that idea of having just that relaxed mindset. Okay, just calm down, do a little Zen thing, do a little meditation, and that settles you down.
You know what helped me as a former racer while I raced was visualizing myself doing it right, taking that gate straighter than I, you know, when I'm looking at the course, I would look at my line and I would imagine myself doing it right and going fast.
Yeah, mental imagery, that's a whole other interview, but that is the most powerful mental tool there is. And everybody on the World Cup at the Olympics, they use imagery. You see them at the start doing it, you see them when they're inspecting, and recreational skiers can do it too, especially we've got a really steep bump run here, for example, and at the top it's pretty intimidating, but if a skier closes their eyes and see themselves, the track they want to do down, then that builds into their mind successful skiing and a way down, and it builds their confidence as well, and it relaxes them because they've got a plan.
They have a plan and they know what they're going to do. They execute.
Then they execute, exactly.
Well, Jim, this has been so helpful, I think, to everyone that competes in every sport or plays tennis or does anything for recreational enjoyment and exercise. You can make them better by just having taken account of everything he said about confidence and focus and practice. So thank you.
My pleasure. It's been really fun.
See, it was good to have a sports psychologist on the show. We're all going to be better. Thanks for the run. Let's go skiing.
Okay.
For more Snow Motion fun, log on to my website at snow-motion.com.
What we've done at Surefoot has really changed the way that you get ski boots. The sun shines bright. This boot is made for your foot. The difference is amazing. You'll ski better. They're better fitting, better skiing than anything you've ever experienced. I woke up feeling great. Today was made for me.
And life is good the way it should.
In 2009, High Fives was formed to help athletes that have suffered a life-altering injury return to the sport they love.
He said, whatever you need,
we'll help you make happen.
To become a member or to help support the cause, go to highfivesfoundation.org.
Vail's Gondola One, right from Vail Village. This is a fancy gondola. It has heated seats and its own Wi-Fi. We're gonna check out Warren Miller's movie, No Turning Back, and this clip is all about Beaver Creek.
They've been ski racing in the Vail Valley since 1962. They would have started earlier, but the lifts weren't built yet. In those days, all the really serious racers were in Europe, so Vail imported guys like 1960 Olympic champion Roger Staub from Switzerland. Where Staub was from, ski racing is king. And his adopted hometown learned to treat it the same way. But a funny thing happened over the next few decades. We took our lumps, figured this racing thing out, and eventually, we got pretty good. Then, we got really good.
Of Beaver Creek, Colorado. What a weekend of racing action we have lined up for you. Chris Davenport alongside Doug Lewis. We'll be bringing you all the action. And Doug, new courses this year, new athletes, and all built up for the 2015 World Alpine Championships next year. This is big.
We really spend most of our season in Europe. You know, bouncing from France to Germany to Austria to Switzerland and Beaver Creek is going to be awesome.
It's a good thing we can hold our own against the best in Europe now, because that's who's coming to Vail and Beaver Creek this winter. More than 700 of the best racers on the planet.
And slow three roll. Ski racing is probably one of the most historic sports on Earth. And this place right here, Vail Beaver Creek, is steeped in history. Two world championships and another one coming up.
Racing in Beaver Creek is challenging. It's one of our toughest races of the year, so nothing to lose.
At Beaver Creek, there's one great equalizer. From Olympic champions to first-timers on vacation, everyone gets a cookie. Everyone, that is, but the World Cup ski technicians.
Equipment is pretty much the most important thing when you're racing. All of your skis have to be dialed in, and not only do they have to be fast, but all the way into the boots. So I just work closely with my tech, and yeah, I just want to feel super comfortable when I'm standing in the start gate. and know that I don't have to worry about anything else but hurling my body down the hill.
Downhill courses like Beaver Creek's Birds of Prey are just like F1 tracks. They each have their own personality, but they're only designed for one thing.
World Cup downhill in Super G, it's tricking your mind to like send yourself down there as fast as you can.
You really gotta look for every meter of top position.
If you're not on your game, then bad things can happen.
Racers have to be on it. You know, we have to be pretty focused on what we do. We have to be good at what we do to be able to not end up in the fences every week. A big fear factor for the racers and excitement for the fans who are watching.
First time was a little scary. About 18 years old, I couldn't even sleep that night because I was so petrified.
If I'm not scared, I'm kidding myself. When you're looking out of the start gate, you have to be ready to get it on.
To take the ultimate risk, you know, with big crashes and everything, to go fast.
In the Bible of U.S. ski racing, Tommy Moe begot Darren Rawls, and Rawls begot Ted Ligety.
A pretty intense feeling being in the start gate and, you know, knowing you have to push it to that level in order to be fast, but also, you know, wanting to have a little bit of a sense of self-preservation.
It's almost like tapping back into that childhood knowledge of the mountain and remembering that my feet will stay underneath me and letting everything else go. As a child, definitely looked up to Tamara McKinney.
I remember watching Franz Klammer and Phil Mayer, Ingemar Stenmark, and I just knew that I wanted to be a ski racer.
Mark Giardelli and Alberto Tomba, Tommy Moe, AJ Kitt, those were the guys who I thought were really cool growing up.
Peekaboo Street really motivated me to want to be an Olympian.
My dad, Pepe Stiegler, Olympic champion. These Vangen trophies and Kitzbühel trophies.
Beaver Creek set up their best terrain to be gnarlier than the one before. Our average speed in the World Cup is about 70 miles an hour. Guys have actually hit 100 miles an hour.
Breathe down those nerves. You can't worry about what place you're gonna get. You can't worry about the danger. You gotta worry about throwing it.
Those 30 seconds right before you push out of the start are the most important 30 seconds in your life.
Actually, the 30 seconds after you hit 70 miles per hour are pretty important too.
Most exciting story going forward is the young U.S. racer Michaela Schifrin.
She's from Eagle Vale and is such a natural athlete. She doesn't hold back, and for an 18-year-old, it's unbelievable.
Michaela Schifrin is just the latest U.S. racer to put the Europeans on notice and get the hometown fans jumping in Red Tail Stadium.
Brody Miller, no stranger to the podium here in Beaver Creek. He's won here many times.
But when he's in the race, people watch. And he's like, no one can send it on this hill like I can. Brody Miller is back.
Ted Ligety, Mr. GS, he's been on fire.
Next. 52 years ago, Vail invited the Europeans to help them learn a thing or two about ski racing. This winter, all of Europe is invited once again, but this time, we're going to show them how it's done.
Yeah.
the Olympics, the World Championships are it. Fourth place is the same as last place, so everybody raises their game, the intensity's higher, and that's when the magic happens.
You would never guess how your ski coat zipper would guide you to better skiing. Stay with us on Snow Motion, and I'll show you how.
It's a place where I feel at home. Every run is an adventure.
Vail, it's like nothing on earth.
What we've done at Surefoot has really changed the way that you get ski boots.
The sun shines bright.
This boot is made for your foot. As the difference is amazing. You'll ski better. They're better fitting, better skiing than anything you've ever experienced.
I woke up feeling great. Today was made for me. And life is good the way.
In 2009, High Fives was formed to help athletes that have suffered a life-altering injury return to the sport they love.
He said, whatever you need, we'll help you make happen.
To become a member or to help support the cause, go to highfivesfoundation.org.
SnowMotion is brought to you by Vail, like nothing on earth. And by Marker Vocal, rule the mountain. I'm going to call this tip the zipper tip. It's so easy. All you have to do is keep the zipper of your ski coat facing down the hill. To do that, you can think, drive the inside shoulder into the turn. It also causes separation between your lower and upper body. This puts power on your downhill ski. If you don't drive the inside shoulder into the turn, but let it open up when you finish your turn, your zipper will be facing the side of the trail. That makes your body go in a straight line and it loses the separation between your lower and upper body. When your body is straight like this, you lose the angle on that downhill ski. You want to have the separation between your lower and upper body to keep the power and angle on the downhill ski, and then you will carve turns. So remember, after you plant the pole, drive the inside shoulder through the turn. You know if you're doing it right if your zipper is facing down the hill. Sage Katzenberg caught the snowboarding bug when he was a little boy. Let's learn more about this Olympic snowboarder.
Pretty much was raised in Park City, Utah, and I started skiing when I was four, and then my brother actually was super not into skiing, and he was just like, screw this, going snowboarding, and I was just like, me too, you know, I'm over this. I'm doing whatever Blaze is doing, my brother. The Olympics came to Park City when I was in third grade, so around when I was 8 or 9 years old, I was like, this is insane. I just got hooked on everything, like filming side of snowboarding, the competing side, it was just like everything, I wanted to do everything. 10 or 11, I started going to Wendell's and going to Mount Hood every year and High Cascade and all that. It was just like winter wonderland in summer, you know? It was just a bunch of kids shredding in summer. You know, you could wear t-shirts and it was just insane. So I've been back almost every single year since I was 10. First time I did good at Breck, I was 16 and it was the first Dew Tour of the year and I ended up getting second. And that was actually the start of the season where I won the Dew Cup. And I got invited to X Games that year and everything. It was just the sickest year. I would not be anywhere close to where I am today without my parents. They drove me and my friends a bunch of places, for competing. They would fly back east to US Open. My mom went to Europe with me. We've been all over the place, and I really owe it all to them. To this day, I still just ride to have fun, and the Olympics is sick, and it's an awesome goal to go there, and it'd be sick to get a medal, but I think if you go there and you just have fun and soak in the whole experience of being at the Olympics, I think that's way sicker.
Thanks for watching this edition of SnowMotion. I hope you enjoyed meeting talented athletes and watching incredible skiing. I'm Brenda Buglione, and we'll see you next week on the slopes.
Would it be easier if we had no shoes, no time to kill, and nothing to lose, and no worries but the great blue sky? And looking for shade when the sun gets high, we're climbing up that coconut tree. If it's time for one of nature's treats, would it be easier?